May God bless America when our causes are just. And may God help America repent when we're on the wrong path.
Amen.
Welcome to Frankfort. This is your capital. It belongs to every Kentuckian. And we appreciate you coming. Make yourself at home. I don't know you personally, but I kind of know who you are, and I submit to you that Frankfort needs your presence here, and it needs your wisdom. So I thank you for making the sacrifice and coming from across this state to stand together for religious liberty and freedom of conscience. In some sense, this is a family reunion with family members that have never met one another. But we all are curious, where are we from? I'm curious, do we have any folks from Ashland? Anybody? Okay, there's some Ashland. How about Moorhead? All right, okay, I can understand that one. Pikeville, anyone from Pikeville? Okay, Pikeville's down there, okay. How about Hazard? Anybody from Hazard? Let it be, okay. Moving across north, Northern Kentucky. Anyone from Northern Kentucky? Okay, how about Lexington? That's a neighboring county. How about Somerset and Russell Springs? And I want to thank David Carr and King of Kings Radio for all the work that he's done in putting that portion of the rally together. Thank you. Thank you for coming that distance. That's a great sacrifice. And the legislators and the governor need to know that this is a Kentucky-wide gathering. Just shout it out. Are there any Methodists here? Okay, they're Methodists. Any Churches of Christ? How about independent Christian churches? Are there any Catholics here? How about Assemblies of God Pentecostal? Any independent Baptists? How about Southern Baptists? Any Southern Baptists? Isn't it interesting? Separate Baptists. The separate Baptists are the ones that are standing separately over there, okay? I'm teasing. Isn't it interesting that a little adversity can bring an answer to that one unanswered prayer of Jesus? Jesus prayed that we would be one. Amen. And sometimes we're unwilling to be one, but a little push and a little shove and all of a sudden we're standing. Let me describe very carefully what we are doing here. First of all, I want to describe what we are not doing here. We are not here to protest. We're not angry at the Supreme Court. I believe they made a poor decision. They've made them before. Dred Scott, Roe versus Wade. It was not a good legal decision, it was not a good historical decision, and I believe it bodes poorly for the future. But we're not here to bash the Supreme Court. That's not why we're here. Similarly, this is not an anti-gay or anti-lesbian rally. If you want to protest anti-gay and anti-lesbian messages, go to another rally. That's not what this is about. All humanity needs the living God, and that's what we're bearing witness to. But we've called this the First Amendment rally, standing with the county clerks. And the reason why it's the First Amendment, is because the First Amendment has five liberties in it. And those five liberties we are working on today, all at one time. The First Amendment reads, Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion. In other words, they can't force religion down anyone's throats, like was done to our forefathers before they came to America. So they made sure Congress cannot force religion down somebody's throats. But it also goes on to say, government, in essence, can't prohibit the free exercise of religion. Or abridge the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of people to peaceably assemble and to petition the government for redress of grievances. Now you understand, we're doing all of those things today. And we're standing for the First Amendment because if any of those realms are hindered, then all of those realms are hindered. The media is here today, and we stand for their freedom of the press, and we trust that they'll record this with liberty. But we're also standing here for the church and Christians and people like the county clerks, where there is pressure on them to violate their deeply held religious convictions. What we'd like to do is take a moment, invite Pastor Cecil Bly to come forward. He's the pastor of Louisville's More Grace Ministries. He's been in Kentucky many times, and been in the Capitol many times, and oftentimes he leads the stand for the sanctity of human life. He's a passionate pastor, and he will lead us to the throne room.
Amen.
God bless you, Kent. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask that you pour your spirit upon this event and upon our efforts to maintain and protect freedom of religion and freedom of expression. You said in your word that where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. We come to stand for that liberty and to protect that liberty. You also said in your word that many are called, but few are chosen. Choose us this day. Use us this day. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. In Kentucky, in America, and in this earth, as it is in heaven. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
America, even during World War II, where our future was in question, the conscientious objector that could not pull a trigger to kill another human being was honored and granted his freedom because America respects the individual. The First Amendment was given to each individual. It wasn't given to the church. It wasn't given only to ministers and pastors. It was given to every American citizen. It is the cornerstone of our birthright as Americans, and we must stand for it, for that principle. If we do not, America will no longer be America. We are that city on a hill to the rest of the nation, rest of the world. We are not perfect, but we are a light to the nations, and our light grows dim when we allow the First Amendment to be infringed in any way. There are a number of key legal plumb lines that these county clerks are standing on. I mentioned the first one, the First Amendment. But there's another one that I want to explain to you briefly so that you can go home and explain this to others. It's critically important. There are about four touchstones in law that make up the cases that will protect these county clerks from giving up their freedom of conscience. But there's one right here in Kentucky called the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. It was passed in 2013. It was modeled after the Federal Religious Freedom Restoration Act that was passed in 1993. And it was passed by 532 legislators. Only three senators did not vote for it. It was supported by the left and the right. It was supported even by the ACLU. And the Kentucky version of it is very much the same. And what it says is this: religious liberty, freedom of conscience, is so important that government must have a critical, compelling interest, is the legal term, if it ever infringes at all on anyone's religious liberty. But if it has to infringe on that religious liberty, it must do so in the least restrictive way. And to explain that, that's a lot of legal jargon, but to explain that is, when you think of the Amish, and this happened in Kentucky, when you think of the Amish, they like to be out of sight. They don't like to have a lot of notoriety. They wear dark clothing, drive black buggies. They don't want to be the spotlight of anything. Of course, at night at 11 o'clock on a highway, a two-lane highway at 55 miles an hour, there is a compelling interest of safety. Because if you're moving 55 miles an hour and you don't see that black buggy, somebody could get hurt. Somebody in the buggy or when the driver pulls off to miss it. There's a compelling interest there. And so the state first came up and said, let's put that orange triangle on the back of that buggy. You can imagine how the Amish felt about that. That's not what they're about. Now, you and I both know that the black buggies causes everybody to turn their heads and say, look at the black buggy. So we do see them, you know what I'm saying? It kind of catches our attention. But they couldn't do with a orange triangle on the back of their buggy. And so the best way, by the way, look at our friend up here with a message. Stand fast, Kim. So the best way that government could adjust to facilitate their concerns was to back off the bright orange and let them have simply a white triangle that reflects, so that the safety concern, the compelling interest is met, but also the religious liberty and the rights of conscience are protected. Amen. That is the Religious Freedom Restoration Act in action. It is the law of this state. And so now we have a compelling interest of government to get marriage licenses to whom they belong. But we also have several county clerks, three who are standing firm, that cannot violate their consciences. Yeah. They cannot violate their consciences by signing their name to authorize something that they believe is unholy. And so the duty of government is to come up with a way to get the licenses to those who need them, but to protect the consciences. One suggestion has been come up with the 121st county clerk that would work online here at the Capitol so that people could get it online. They wouldn't even have to drive to their county clerk's office. That is one alternative. I don't know what the best alternative is, but it's incumbent on government to do the least restrictive means, and to date, the government has done nothing. In fact, I'm embarrassed to say this, but the governor has said, bless his heart, he has said, let's let the courts and the county clerks work it out. Do you understand what that means? That means that Kim Davis is being sued by the ACLU and a number of plaintiffs, and they're going after her not just professionally, but personally, because they want court costs, they want attorney's fees, and they want punitive damages to punish her for her convictions. That is un-American. Let me underscore one other thing. The governor vetoed that piece of legislation in 2013. But the legislature overrode the veto. The question is, why is he reluctant to submit himself to the law that all the rest of us abide by, which is least restrictive means for protections? When we passed that legislation, when legislators passed it and we were lobbying for it, what we said was, this is a shield, not a sword. It's not designed to hurt anyone, it's designed to protect religious conscience. We are not here to say, you cannot pass out the marriage licenses. That's now the law that the Supreme Court has settled. But we are here to say, do not step on freedom of conscience. And I want to close the loop on that law so that's clear for everyone. There is something called a local mandate estimate that the LRC, the Legislative Research Commission, serves legislators with. They always tell them how much this piece of legislation is going to cost the local community if it's passed, so that they just don't willy-nilly pass bills that bankrupt cities and counties. So the LRC, which serves Republicans, Democrats, liberals, and conservatives, wrote their estimate about this bill, and I'm going to read what it says. Because I want you to know that this particular crisis that we're having in Kentucky was already contemplated and was part of that bill. May, through the claim of freedom of religion, require action on the part of the local government entity to provide that service in the least burdensome way. Additionally, the least restrictive alternative required of local government may be minimal. For example, in adjusting the timing of certain events in a jail. Or significant, for example, if it requires hiring additional staff or paying overtime for other workers to do a job that an employee declines to do because of religious beliefs. Do you see how all the legislators, when they passed that, understood that government would turn itself inside out, not to step on anyone else's religious freedom and freedom of conscience? So the bottom line of this crisis, where the governor has said to these county clerks, do your job or quit, the reality is we're in essence politely saying, governor, please do your job or quit. I know in history you may remember this phrase at one point. Abraham Lincoln, when he met Harriet Beecher Stowe, the author of Uncle Tom's Cabin, he told her, he said, so you're the little woman who wrote the book that started the Great War. Well, it's my privilege to introduce Kim Davis to you. She's the little woman that started this great debate. Kim Davis.
I am totally overwhelmed by this show of support. I first must give thanks and praise to God Almighty. He is my strength and He is my comfort. He gives me a peace in my soul that no one can take from me. He gives me a joy in my heart that can't nobody have. I can give it away, but there's nobody. Nobody can take that from me. Yeah. And I want to thank Him for that, for He is a mighty God. Worthy to be praised. Worthy, worthy, worthy. He's worthy. He's so worthy. I want to thank you all so much for sacrificing your time, your day, to come down and show support. I can't say a whole lot, but I love each and every one of you, and I desire your prayers. I need your prayers. We all need your prayers. Just continue to stand firm in what we believe. God is alive and He's on the throne. I tell you, He's alive and He's on the throne. Thank you.
Isaiah 59 says, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard. And I want you to understand that the standard was in warfare. Back then, and during the Revolutionary War and Civil War, soldiers only knew their place on the battlefield by following their company's standard. When the standard fell, they were in disarray. But when God lifts up a standard, when a soldier would lift up a standard, the soldiers knew where to rally. Do you understand that these three clerks are the standards that God has raised up, that we can stand with them?
It is my pleasure to introduce the next county clerk, clerk of Whitley County. Kay Swartz has served the people of Whitley County since 1975. She has been elected by the majority of voters in Whitley County now for the third term. She stands for her First Amendment, religious liberty. Welcome, Kay Swartz.
The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want.
We shall not want. In the name of Jesus, I warned Brother Kent in an interview that I did. They asked me if I would, shouldn't I be politically correct? And I said, no, politically correct does not have life everlasting. But biblically correct does, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming today. Thank you for standing. We love all of you.
It is now my privilege to introduce the next county clerk, the clerk from Casey County, who has had the opportunity to stand not only in his county, but to do many interviews and had the opportunity to go to Washington, D.C. and let them know he is not ashamed. He is not ashamed to be a born-again Christian. He's not ashamed of the religious liberty. Please welcome Casey County Clerk, Casey Davis.
Did Steve Beshear ever get in office? I was asked this a minute ago and what I thought about all this. And this is my response, to you now. How is it that this many people with the connections and the people that you know cannot get on the phone when you leave here today and call enough people to beat Jack Conway and to beat Andy Beshear? Now, your religious freedom, this is a religious freedom rally, isn't it? One of your freedoms as an American, as a Kentucky citizen, is to go vote. I've heard so many people say, well, what do we need to do? What is it that we need to, how do we need to fight this? I'll tell you a good way to start. If you're not registered to vote, go register. And in November, go vote against Andy Beshear and Jack Conway. They have both publicly, Andy's dad has told me to either leave my personal beliefs at the door or do the honorable thing and resign. When did we start electing people to the office of governor that would look our young people in the eye, us in the eye, and tell us that if we have to go on our convictions, just to quit what we're doing? I'm not ready to quit, are you? I believe this today. I believe that there's enough power in the voice of these people right here that we can put God back in government where he belongs. A lot of people would argue about the separation of church and state. Let me say a little bit about that. When did our state ever need more church in it than it does today? When did our state, when did our governor, our government ever need people with a godly conscience more than it needs today? When did we start electing people that would okay a woman to go and have her child ripped out of her womb and his body part sold? When did we start electing people that when we had four ambassadors in our country, representing our country, that all they asked for was a little help from their president and from their secretary of state, and they rolled over in bed and didn't send them any help and they lost their lives? When did we start electing people like that? I'm tired of seeing heathenistic views in our offices, aren't you? Let me tell you what prayer can do. We serve a sovereign God. Do you believe that today? Do you know what prayer can do? Prayer can change things. Your voice can change things. Your convictions, and I'm going to tell you right now, your convictions if your convictions go from the Word of God, you need to go by them regardless of what Steve has shared. I've been told this over and over again, that I'm stepping on the Constitution. That I'm not upholding, I was told it by Steve Beshear, that I was not upholding my oath that I took. I took that oath to do the job of county clerk to the best of my ability, so help me God. Yeah. And in that oath, I raised my hand and I said I would support the Constitution of this United States and the Constitution of this Commonwealth. And that I've been doing, regardless of what other people may think. You know what? In 2004, there was a law that was voted on, passed here in this state, to allow the voters to determine what defined marriage. First of all, God defined that a long time ago. Regardless of what any man puts on a piece of paper, the law of nature is not going to change. Do you know that? So let me go on a little bit with that. I want to read to you a couple of sections of the Kentucky Constitution. I brought them with me today. And I want you to be the judge, because you've got just as much right to be the judge as a lot of these guys wearing black robes do. So I want you to be the judge on what your Constitution says, what your Bill of Rights say, and then tell me that who it is in this state that's upholding their oath. Listen to this. This is Section 26 of the Bill of Rights of the state of Kentucky. To guard against transgression of the high powers which we have delegated, federal government, Supreme Court, to guard against the transgression of the high powers which we have delegated, we declare that everything in this Bill of Rights is accepted out of the general powers of government and shall forever remain inviolate, and all laws contrary thereto or contrary to this Constitution shall be void. What about that, Kentuckians? What about that, Americans? What about Section 5 that goes on when Miss Davis back here behind me, who I have, so I've been asked over and over again, are you all related? I said, absolutely. She's my sister. We're related through the blood of Jesus Christ.